Good afternoon, friends. First of all, I thank Dr. Srinivas sir for giving me this opportunity. I am going to talk about psychological state and balance function. How psychology affects the balance? Good physician will treat the disease, but the great physician will treat the whole patient. Means we have to not only treat the vertigo, but also we have to treat the associated psychological conditions. In my practice, psychological vertigo is the third most common form of vertigo OPD patient after BPPV and migraine. More you senior in vertigo practice, more and more psychological patient come with you. Outline of my presentation. Who is likely to have a primary psychiatric disorder? Who is not likely to respond well to treatment? What are some signature psychiatric gait and eye abnormalities? The relationship between psychological state and balanced performance. And what is chronic subjective dizziness or postural phobic vertigo? And how to identify and treat chronic subjective dizziness? First, who is likely to have a primary psychiatric disorders? It is often very difficult to know whether the dizziness is causing the psychiatric manifestation or whether the primary psychiatric disorder is causing dizziness. Severe impairment of ability to function is more in the presence of psychiatric disorders than with the vestibular disorders. Presence of following in non-acute setting is likely because of primary psychiatric disorders. Repetitive nausea, vomiting, palpitation, weakness, difficulty with speech. Point to be noted, non-acute setting. Who is not going to respond well to treatment? Best longitudinal predictors for poor outcome are autonomic symptoms like patient having a heart pounding, excessive sweating, hot or cold spells, feeling faint or shortness of breath. Somatization. General tendency to complain of a diversity of unrelated health problems ranging from pain in the back to difficulty in concentrating. High level of anxiety at the onset of vertigo, excessive vigilance about the vestibular symptoms, catastrophic thinking about possible adverse outcome are the best predictors for persistent dizziness and unsteadiness. Now, examination. Psychogenic stance and gait, what are they? Momentary fluctuation of stance is seen often in response to suggestions. Excessive slowness or hesitation of locomotion, it is incompatible with any neurological disease. Psychogenic Romberg test, what are that? So in patient, build up to sway amplitude after a silent latency. It take a few minutes of silent latency period or exaggerated sway is seen. But often, sway is improved by distraction. While in acute auto-neurological condition, sway is worse by distraction. In psychological patient, it is improved. Uneconomic posture with wastage of muscular energy. Walking on ice gait pattern. Small cautious step. Patient taking a small cautious step with fixed ankle joint, like he is walking on ice. Sudden buckling of knees, usually without falling and patient still able to walk. Convergent spasm. Convergence of the eye with associated pupillary constrictions is seen. It looks very dramatic and scary. It is two types, functional and organic. It is aphysiological functional when episodic and when there are no other oculomotor defects. Consider convergence spasm as an organic basis when the pupillary abnormality is chronic and when there is an upgaze-based defect. You will see the video of convergence spasm. See, both pupils are going medially. Another finding is voluntary nystagmus. Initially in the past in America, used by men to avoid military drafts. Voluntary nystagmus represents a saccadic flutters initiated by conversion with no intersaccadic interval. Voluntary nystagmus is vary in amplitude and latency. See, this is voluntary flutter. Smart psycho patient can do it. We can't do it. Now, chronic subjective dizziness. Karl Westphal has a given theory in long back 1871 about the locomotion. Integral component of locomotion are three: postural control, spatial orientation, and threat assessment. Westphal identify all the three component as integral to locomotion. As person who can walk on a narrow strip on the floor, shakes and fall when asked to do the same thing on a narrow wall at a height. The physiology and law of physics are same, but here threat assessment related to consequences of fall impairs the locomotion. But unfortunately, this early identification of unity of components involved in the locomotion was soon forgotten in the past. Anxiety was become a part of psychiatry and postural control become a part of neurology. Now, there is a rule by neuro-otologists to see the components as an integral to locomotions. That brings us to the diagnosis of chronic subjective dizziness and the closely related condition, phobic postural vertigo. Identifying this condition is very important because the success that can be achieved with direct treatment. Classification, definition. Stab and Rukestan given a definition of chronic subjective dizziness. It contains mainly three parts: persistent non-vertiginous dizziness lasting for 3 months or more. Here dizziness is persistent, it is non-vertiginous and lasting long. Patient having a hypersensitivity to motion stimuli, including patient's own movement and motion of the object in the visual surroundings. Difficulty with precision of visual tasks such as reading a printed paper or using a computer. Chronic subjective dizziness is usually triggered by acute otoneurological condition, medical condition, or psychiatric illness. It is closely related to phobic postural vertigo. Core symptoms of chronic subjective dizziness: non-vertiginous dizziness or swaying, rocking unsteadiness. Dizziness is related to spatial disorientation, unsteadiness related to postural control. It is persistent for months or years long. Dizziness is present throughout the day with waxing and waning in severity. Usually, patient wake up well, but symptom worsens after breakfast. Dizziness is subjective. Subjective unsteadiness is there. When we examined the patient, we couldn't find any unsteadiness. Subjective unsteadiness presents. Patient's complaints are vague, numerous, and out of proportion to findings. Usually, family history of stress and anxiety are present. In pediatric patients, complain most of the time at school going time or at school. Relationship to posture, postural relationship. Symptoms usually worse with sitting, standing, and walking. Usually symptoms are less while reclining, but it need not be absent. It should be differentiated from orthostatic and positional symptoms. Orthostatic symptoms are related to immediately after assuming an upright position, immediately. Positional symptoms are related to subject entering in a particular position as in BPPV and related disorders. Though the chronic subjective dizziness patient may have these features, it is seen as a part of hypersensitivity to motion in all directions. Provocating factors, what are that? Body motion. Active body motion or passive body motions, not related to any specific direction. Exposure to large visual flow, like watching a moving train or moving a fast vehicle, or while performing a precision visual task such as reading a newspaper or using a computer. how this motion sensitivity different from that seen in migraine and manias. In migraine and manias, the patient feels better in the intractile period, symptoms reduce while removing the stimuli. Whereas in chronic subjective dizziness, the symptom persists even after removing the stimuli and even persists for hours or days after removing the stimuli. Precipitating factors usually followed by primary vestibular disorders like BPPV, vestibular neuronitis, vestibular migraines, panic attacks, traumatic mild brain injury, generalized anxiety, dysautonomias. Investigations. Generally, physical examination often normal. Normal findings on all vestibulometric tests. Even sometimes when abnormal findings are present, they are not sufficient to explain the possible all symptoms. Here, role of physical examination, vestibulometric test, neuroimaging are not to diagnose the chronic subjective dizziness itself, but to diagnose the possible coexisting condition. Mechanism of chronic subjective dizziness development. How chronic subjective dizziness develop? When acute vestibular event causes dependence on the intact sensory input, like ignoring vestibular inputs and hyperdependence on visual somatosensory inputs. Once the vestibular event is resolved, the patient should go back to normal processings. However, when the anxiety and other predisposing factors are present, it ensues that adaptive process persists beyond the time in which it was needed. This extended adaptive response beyond the true period causing become the maladaptive response. Treatment. Usually combination therapy will help. Vestibular and balance rehabilitation therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, and medications. Vestibular and balance rehabilitation therapy. It reduces the severity of symptoms, reduces anxiety and depression, improve the confidence in patient. Initially, it must be start under supervision. How vestibular and balance rehabilitation therapy is different in psychological, in chronic subjective dizziness than in the acute vestibular problems. Pacing. Pacing means habituation exercise being more gently and increase slowly than vestibular problem exercise. Persistent. Exercise takes more longer time than vestibular problem. Visual flow and visual complexity. Visual flow and visual complex stimuli address the visual symptoms. Real world setting means use of indoor and outdoor setting of the patient that patient encounter in daily routine life. It promotes the reintegration into the daily activities of patient. Cognitive behavioral therapy. If identified early, it works well. Medications. SSRI and SNRI. Here, say no to labyrinthine sedatives, remember. Fluoxetine, SSRI. Initially start with lower dose, 5 to 10 milligram daily, then increase to 10 to 20 milligram by 2 weeks, then titrate the dose according to response and over 4 to 6 weeks to reach the therapeutic dose of 20 to 60 milligram. Maintenance therapy has to be given for a minimum of 1 year depending upon the response. If one drug fail, use another SSRI or SNRI. Wait minimum 3 months before deciding non-response to medications. Other alternative SSRI are sertraline, paroxetine, citalopram, escitalopram, fluoxetine. Alternative SNRI are venlafaxine, milnacipran, duloxetine. Remember, only medicine can't cure the patient. Always, always use combination therapy. Strict follow-up and reassurance is also very important. Treatment of specific problems. Routine phobic vertigo complaints in my practice are feel imbalance while looking up at building, feel imbalance while looking at moving vehicles, feel imbalance while gathering in crowd. I think yesterday symptom-specific rehabilitation therapy is covered. How to prevent psychological overlay? Positive discussion with patient. In the very first day, while patient come with us, we should discuss each and every point of diagnosis, point of treatment, how his disease will remain, what are you doing for his disease. It prevents the psychological overlay. Educate the patient by videos and also in chronic patient stress reducing programs. Thank you.